and sing. Lift those voices. Amen. Can I get an amen? Amen. All right. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your hearts. Come, just as you are, to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. My brother, come. Now is the time to give your hearts. Come, just as you are. Come, just as you are before your God. Come, one day. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. One day. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes. Open the eyes. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes. Open the eyes. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up. Shining, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. To see you high and lifted up. Shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love. I want to see you. I want to see Jesus lifted high. Banner that flies across this land. Let all men see the truth and know he is the way to heaven. I want to see. Come on, put those hands together. Pump up the praise. God dwells in the praises of his people. It's okay. church. I wanna see Jesus lifted high. I wanna see Jesus lifted high. Step by step, we're moving forward. Little by little, we're taking ground. Every prayer a powerful weapon. Strongholds come tumbling down and down and down and down and down. We wanna see Jesus lifted high. A banner that flies across this land, that all men may see the truth and know. We wanna see Jesus lifted high. A banner that flies across this land, that all men may see the truth and know. He is the way to heaven. We wanna see Jesus lifted high. We wanna see Jesus lifted. Step by step, moving forward, we're taking ground. Every prayer a powerful weapon. Strongholds come tumbling down and down and down and down. Hallelujah. Come, let us pray. This one to the Lord, lift up your eyes, lift up your voice, lift up your hands, cause in His love we can rejoice. Lift up your eyes, lift up your voice, lift up your hands, cause in His love we can rejoice. Come, let us praise, lift up your eyes to the Lord. Come, let us praise. Lift up your eyes. Lift up your eyes. Lift up your hearts. Lift up your voice. Cause in His love we can rejoice. Lift up your eyes. Lift up your voice. Lift up your hearts. Cause in His love we can rejoice. Come, let us praise. Come on, lift up those hands and worship the Lord with me. Give me a wave. Come, let us praise. Lift up. Lift up your eyes. Lift up your voice. Lift up your hearts. Lift up your eyes. Lift up your hearts. Lift up your voice. Come, let us praise. Lift up your eyes to the Lord. Come, let us praise. Lift up your eyes to the Lord. Lift up your eyes. Lift up your hearts. Lift up your voice. Cause in His love we can rejoice. Lift up your eyes. Lift up your hearts, cause in His love we can rejoice. Hallelujah. We can rejoice, amen. Because all things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new for the children of God. And that's why we can rejoice. Amen. How many of you today can boast about the goodness of God in your life? Amen? God is a good God. I said to the Lord this morning, you know, Lord, even when I don't consider myself good, You remain faithful. You know, You remain good to me.
That's the difference with God. He don't reward us according to what we deserve. He's different. Despite our sins, despite our faults, our shortcomings, He loves us. And He wants to help us to rise and to become restored into His image and likeness. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's just worship Him with this song.
All my life you
You've been good to us. So good. You never fall short of being good. And we just want to give thee thanks as we celebrate the life of our sister today for your goodness in her life. And you have called her home. And we are left behind to continue, oh God, your work and to lift up her legacy. Continue to bless us and the remainder of this service. In Jesus' name, you may be seated.
Thank you very much, Pastor Taylor. If you knew Astrid well, you know that she was a very determined, and when she stakes a position, she was adamant about it. One of the things I would miss, strangely, is sometimes the argument that we would have. I recall last August, now I consider myself to be a fairly good expert when it comes to real estate investing. And we had a discussion over something, and she was adamant in her disagreement with my conclusion on a particular situation. And I had to say, Astrid, remember, I'm the expert in the field. It doesn't matter. She had her opinion, and she stood by it. You know, one of the things that that really touched me over the last couple of months was to see her in pain, serious pain. In my heart, it was difficult to have experienced that. But you know what? What happened in those situations? Astrid lifted her hands, and she worshipped the God that she served. In all of her pain, she was so determined that she lifted her hands and she worshipped God. And I said, God, I don't know, with all my faith, I don't know if I could do that. But she did. And that reminded me that in crisis and difficulties, you still have to worship God, regardless of what you're going through. And so, as we continue, I just want to make an observation here. It is the very first time that all of us are on the same geographical space, my siblings. It's the first time we are in the same space outside of, in St. Vincent, because we were in the U.S. Recently. First time all of us are in St. Vincent at the very first time. And then why? It's all because of Astrid. Even in debt, she's still bringing us together. At this time, I want to call my oldest brother for my mom, all the way from Canada. He could not resist coming and being here with us and having this fellowship with us, Ronald. We want to invite him now to come, and he's going to read our first scripture this morning.
Corinthians 15, verses 12 through 20. But if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are found to be false witnesses about God, for we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead, but he did not raise him. In fact, the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only this life we have hoped in Christ, we are all people most to be pitied. But Christ has indeed been risen from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep.
Thank you, Ron. We should be having a congregational hymn, Great Is Thy Faithfulness. I don't know if the guys were. And then we would have a poem from Astrid's daughter, Siobhan. And following that, we'd have the obituary by Rainey. Right. So let's do Great Is Thy Faithfulness. Praise the Lord. I don't know how many of you knew, but Astrid was also ordained a minister of the gospel. All right, it testified again to her commitment to Christ.
Let us stand.
Thou forever will be.
sin and the peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. All mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness. It is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercy I see. All I have needed, thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. God bless you.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You may be seated. At this time, we want to play the video from Chevron.
This is a poem for my mama, aka my Astrid. It's called My Mother Kept a Garden. My mother kept a garden, a garden of the heart. She planted all the good things that give my life a start. She turned me to the sunshine and encouraged me to dream, fostering and nurturing the seeds of my self-esteem. And when the winds and the rain came, she protected me enough, but not too much, because she knew I'll stand up strong and tough. Her constant good example always taught me right from wrong, markers for my pathway that will last a lifetime long. I am my mother's garden. I am her legacy. And I hope today she feels the love reflected back from me. Rest in peace, my sweet mama, until we meet again.
In church. Astrid Haynes passed away on September 11th, 2023. I'm sorry, November 11th, 2023. She was born in Carlyacqua, St. Vincent and the Grenadines to parents Luther Haynes and Carlton Samuel. She attended the Carlyacqua Anglican School and ranked it 10th nationwide on the Common Entrance Exam, which allowed her to attend the country's prestigious high school, the Girls High School in Kingstown. Later, Astrid attended St. Vincent Technical College and graduated as salutatorian. Subsequently, she worked with the government in the House of Assembly Department. She worked at Geese Industries and then at Joachim's Engineering. After migrating to New York, Astrid attended York College, City University of New York, where she graduated magna cum laude with a bachelor's degree in accounting. She later became the financial controller at Kingdom Life Ministries and also worked with New York City College of Technology. Astrid is survived by her daughter, Siobhan Haynes, mother, Luther Haynes, father, Carlton Samuel, sisters, myself, Renee, Carolyn Baines, Petran Chalupnik, and Colette Samuel. Brothers, Ronald Haynes, Kevin Barnady, Peter Barnady. sister-in-laws Wendy Haynes, Heather Barnady, Shelly Ann Barnady, brother-in-law David Chalupnik, aunts Merlene Hercules and family, Wilma Jack and family, Elsie Jones and family, Ruth Stephen and family, uncles Felix Haynes and Elroy Haynes, nephews Matthew Haynes, Joshua Barnady, Caleb Barnady, Miles Barnady, Sawyer Chalupnik, Landon Chalupnik, nieces Jemima Babb, Crystal Barnady, Lisa Singer, and Stephanie Taylor Brown. Many cousins, including Yvonne Lane, Deirdre Adams, Colin Adams, Yolande Haynes, Francine Valentine, Derek Fraser, Marcus Fraser, and Candy Fraser Fardou. Russell Hercules, Kieran Haynes and family, including Cassian Cupid, Mark Haynes, Sweeney Haynes, Lee Mark Rose, Richard Cato Knights and family. The Lewis family, including Dr. Linton Lewis and QC Stanley Starkey John. The Haynes family, the Goodluck family, the Simmons family, Marilyn Jones and Reverend Jones and family. The Mars family, great nieces and nephews, Aaliyah, Braden, Gianna, Obi, Aiden, Alexander, and Benjamin. Many friends, including Erica Kamabach, Andy Legitwood, Candice Horn, Maureen Tash, Maureen Ingracia, Maxine Ford, Kathleen Barnady, Hazel MacMillan, Lavon Ash, Pastor George Fredericks and family, the entire Kingdom Life Ministries family, and the entire Hilltop Tabernacle Church family. Astrid will be missed, but will be in our hearts forever. May she rest in eternal peace.
All right. We have a solo at this time, and we're going to invite back again my good friend, Pastor Fidel Taylor. He's going to be singing Bridge Over Troubled Waters.
Sky.
This time, we're going to have the second scripture reading by Auntie Wilmer. So please come at this time. Let's welcome her, please.
Thank you, my favorite nephew. I say that to all of them, so it's okay. Right, Peter? You're all my favorite. I am so happy to be here today to join you in the celebration of Astrid's life. And so, good morning. The lesson is taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, reading from verse 13. But we would not have you, ignorant brethren, concerning them that fall asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as the rest who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, them also that have fallen asleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we that are alive, that are left unto the coming of the Lord, shall in no wise precede them that are fallen asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise. Then we that are alive, that are left, shall together with them be caught up in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Thank you.
Thank you, Auntie Wilmer. At this time, I want to call my youngest sister, Petran, and she's going to do the eulogy for us.
Good morning. As family and friends, we gather here today to celebrate the life of Astrid Haynes. Astrid has an exceptionally large family and numerous friends whose lives were touched by her. I will share with you some of the thoughts and memories written by several members of her family. James wrote to the believers, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, lacking nothing." And as Kevin said earlier, Astrid's faith was strong to the very end, singing through pain and encouraging us with her faith. Here's a woman whose faith was tested again and again to produce this mighty woman of valor, of unbreakable perseverance. Astrid's faith was the cornerstone of her life. Astrid loved St. Vincent. She loved letting others know all about the lovely things that the island had to offer and about its history, and referred to her storytelling as free commercials for the island. She was well known in Kealakekua, and if anyone went home to visit, everyone was sure to ask for Astrid before they would ask for the rest of us siblings. However, she also loved her new home of New York and enjoyed showing her Vincentian visitors around New York, always telling them, listen, New York is one of the biggest states, and Brooklyn is not just Flatbush. So I'll make sure you get around so that your impression of the city is not skewed. She took them to all the requested shopping hotspots and tourist attraction sites. And I know today she would be so happy that I am finally in Kealakekua. This is such a small example of Astrid's kindness. It would take us all day to talk about her acts of kindness and service. But I think most of you in this room and those who are viewing are nodding their heads, thinking of something kind that she did for you. She constantly made herself available to help everyone unconditionally, at times to her detriment, but she always put others first. This quote by Leo Boccalia really sums up Astrid and the difference she made in many people's lives. Too often, we underestimate the power of a touch, a smile, a kind word, a listening ear, an honest compliment, or the smallest act of caring, all of which have the potential to turn a life around. Among the many things that she was passionate about were her love of reading, playing Scrabble, and consuming political discussions. I remember growing up, she taught me how to play Scrabble, and we spent hours on the porch playing Scrabble. She built my vocabulary, showed me how to get a good score. I also have memories of Astrid coming home from work and being by her bedside as she read a book. We're surely going to miss her predictions and analysis of the upcoming American election. Astrid kept notes and followed the 2-year-long process of electing the president. We can picture her with a notebook which listed all the states and the electoral votes and what states were allocated to. She was known for her analytical skills, which were displayed in full gear. As she deconstructed information from political pundits on topics that she was passionate about and disagreed with the pundits. But beyond her intellect was her unwavering belief in the power of civic engagement. Astrid believed that participation in the democratic process was not just a right, but a duty, one that demanded active involvement and critical thinking. Astrid had an incredible vocabulary and was often heard boasting in a really funny way that she had a prodigious memory. She had an eloquent way of expressing herself and was clear and direct in her communication. This quality is a direct reflection of her passion for reading. She was a family member who we all relied on to provide us invaluable support for writing papers, or if we had a presentation, we'd be quick to ask her, does this sound right? Astrid was also a sports enthusiast with a specific passion for basketball and tennis. She found joy in the strategy, the teamwork, and the sheer thrill of competition that both games have to offer. Her passion for them was not just casual. It was fervent admiration that ignited a spark in her. She was an aficionado in rules of the games and became very animated while watching the matches. Astrid clearly had a passion for all things, for many things, but her greatest love was her daughter, Siobhan. She was a devoted mother and did everything for her daughter's benefit. There were two peas in a pod. We all knew not to get between them. Shay, we don't have to tell you how much your mother loved you. She showed you every day. As a sister, she listened and guided. Renee recalls that Astrid believes that we should not allow our emotions to be in charge, as they inhibit the logical brain from doing its job. As an aunt, she supported and cheered. As a cousin, she was a friend. As a niece, she was respectful. As a sister-in-law, she was your sister. And as a daughter, we watched her care for her mother and her father wholeheartedly. She meant a lot to so many people who have their own individual stories to share of her. Looking back on it now, I understand the urgency that led many of us family members to be by her side, coming from great distances, dropping whatever we were doing to be with her. She was at times very overwhelmed. I remember her looking at me and said, "Petra, you came back." With the outpouring of love and support she received from family members, numerous friends, often when I saw her in October, she would play me the messages that she received from many of you, and she appreciated the prayers and the encouragement that you were giving her. I consider it a blessing that I was able to spend time with her in August, and then just again before she passed away in October. I will cherish those memories forever. Today, all of her siblings, her mother and her father, our family members and friends travel from great distances, Canada and the US, to join with our families here in St. Vincent. And she held each of you very dearly. We have been sad, and we may remain to be sad for a while, that she has left us. But we take great comfort in the belief that she's in a better place with no more pain and no more suffering, and that we would see our beloved Astrid again.
I think it was about a year ago. Can you give me back my book, please? I think it was over a year ago. I don't remember, but in the recent past, I got a text from Astrid. That's how she cares. She said, "Chopins need a bus. You all need to help Chopins, because all those children walking from Chopins coming down to school, and they have to walk back up, because we have a non-profit organization that's been helping folks here on the ground." And so she knew about it. And so she texts me, "You all need to help Chopins now. Get a bus for Chopins." She's always looking out for other people. You know, she sees a need and she's ready to fill it. That's the kind of person she is. Someone told me when recently they came up from St. Vincent and they were walking, they got a job and they lost it and they ran into Astrid on the street. So they were telling her, "Listen, Astrid, I just lost my job. I don't know what I'm going to do." Astrid said, come. Took the lady across to the bank, took her money out and gave it to the lady. That's the kind of person she was. She was selfless. She always wanted to share and look out for others. Now, we want to do some tributes at this time. We had on the list Auntie Merlene. But for those of you who might not be aware, she had to be taken to the hospital. She was not well, and so she could not be here with us today as much as she would have loved to be here. Those of you who know Auntie Merlene knows that she is tight with family, all right? But she couldn't make it today, and so in her place, Ron is going to come and do a eulogy, and then after Ron is done, we would have Sister Greg, Eudine Greg.
Thank you. I'm going to be reading a tribute that Auntie Merlene was going to read, and she sent it to us, so I'll stand in for her today. Astrid, A for amazing, S for sweet, T for talented, I for industrious, D for dedicated. This beautiful young lady called Astrid has left us to be with the Lord. Our Stridey, as some of us called her, was a fantastic God-fearing lady. We may weep over her passing and we may be sorry, but when God calls us, our time to answer, our way to answer is to say, yes, Lord. Astrid was one of those happy, always smiling people. The last time I saw her, we played Scrabble, Mexican dominoes, which apparently has become the Haynes family game of choice. She knew I was coming to see her last September, so she ordered a new game of Scrabble, and when I got there, ordered the Mexican dominoes. Now, if you knew Astrid, you knew she was competitive. She was telling me, as she played, that she had not played in a while. All the meantime, she was busy beating me. Astrid and I shared a special activity at Christmas time. At my Methodist church in Barbados, we usually do talents as a fundraiser. Each class is given $100, and they have to multiply it however they could. Astrid would buy boxes of Christmas cards for me, ties for men, and send them to me. I would turn them over and contribute the money to my class's efforts. I'll miss that little thing that we shared. I miss hearing her calling me Auntie Marlene, the voice filled with laughter. The last time in 2022, when we were in St. Vincent together, I almost missed her as her flight was delayed by a day. But I was determined to see her, so I changed my flight and waited till she came. She wasn't one to complain a lot. When I was with her last year, her phone never stopped ringing with members of her congregation, as was mentioned earlier, calling for advice on one thing or another. So I am imagining her up there in the minister's office, managing things, and everybody calling on her for advice. Such was her dedication to her work and her willingness always to be of service to others, whether family or not. She had such a deep love for our family, and we all returned that love to her. She was one of those nieces who believed in getting a sound education, and she always encouraged her daughter Siobhan to strive for her best. As her Aunt Elsie said, Stridey, you will be missed for so many reasons. Your kindness, your humility, your grace by which you dealt with people. She will miss calling you and hearing, oh, hi, Auntie Elsie. Sorrow fills my heart, tears fill my eyes. Yet all of those emotions do not matter. You're safely tucked away in the arms of the one you believed in all your life. For me, Astrid, you are one of my favorite nieces. You loved laughter. The last time Elsie saw you in 2022, she said you had a great time in Winnipeg at the family wedding. Thank God you were there, and she spent some good times with you. Sweet sleep, my beloved Stridey. Till we meet again, much love and admiration, Auntie Marlene.
Could we have Sister Greg at this time, and then we would have Sister Fedricks after Sister Greg.
Good morning to everybody. Astrid, otherwise known as Stridey, affectionately called by those who grew up with her in this church, Hilltop Tabernacle. It would be remiss of me if I did not include others whose lives she touched and who served with her in various departments. This is what her childhood friends said about her. Stridey and I shared many memorable moments walking up and down the Choppins Road on Sundays to attend church, after which we raced down the road to get freshly dug peanuts and mammy apples from the roadside trees to appease our hunger. After committing our lives to the Lord, we became involved in the life of the church. We were closely together in the youth group, Sunday school, women's ministry, choir, and the youth camps. Stridey loved singing. At Christmas programs, we often sang duets. Later, we formed a group called the Singing Sapphires. We shared the task of getting the right lyrics of songs, listening and re-listening line by line, There wasn't any Google then. In her firmest voice, you'll hear, listen up and learn this song by such and such a date. No ifs, no buts. She was determined and no-nonsense person. So straightforward that she was not afraid to tell you if you were doing foolishness. She loved Scrabble and was an excellent player and even dubbed herself a pro. She eventually migrated to the US, but remained very close friends. One of her Sunday school students had this to say. When I left the junior Sunday school class and moved up to the teens, Astrid was my teacher. She was welcoming and pleasant. She taught us from the Bible and textbooks about who God is and the history of the Bible. She went beyond that. She spoke to us from her own experiences. She nurtured and mothered us. She exemplified what it meant to be Christian. As a student, anywhere she met me on the street, I got that bright smile and an encouraging word. She will be greatly missed. Her assistant in the youth department said, I had the privilege of giving leadership to the youth department alongside Astrid, who was the president. She led by example and was a very good leader who did not stifle anyone's talents. Everyone was given the chance to express themselves. Working with her was a joy. I recall over the years we served together. Only once I saw her angry. Her passing really caught me off guard. She served in the finance department as my assistant. There was not one Sunday when I heard her say, I can't make it today. She was dedicated, consistent, committed, efficient, organized, and reliable. I am so grateful and happy that as I was there, she transitioned from childhood to adolescence to early and middle adulthood. She was a live wire. There are not many more Stridies. My last WhatsApp conversation with her was in August. A few weeks later, I heard of her passing. That Sunday morning in church, I can't tell you what transpired. I was at a loss. This I must say. Mom Lutel, thank you. You shared in this tribute. What is said here today is a testimony that you have inspired godly values in your children. You did not only send her and her siblings, but you brought them along to the house of God. When Astrid migrated to the USA, a void too big to fill was left in the church. Her leaving was a loss to Hilltop and a gain to kingdom life. I believe and I'm convinced that Astrid was aware that her labor in the Lord was not futile, never wasted, or to no purpose. She had gone too soon. But God knows best and does as he pleases. She has left a legacy. Continue to rest steady. You will always be remembered.
Thank you very much, teacher. So we would have Sister Fedrix at this time. She will come on behalf of the Fedrix family, who were very close to Astrid. Pastor Fedrix's wife. Let's welcome her, please.
Good morning, everybody. Well, as he said, I was going to say it, I'm George Frederick's wife. But just last week, when speaking to Shelley Barnaby, when she told me they were coming down for the memorial service, I had a task on my hand. because, you know, my husband has been, had a stroke, and he's not able to talk, and we felt we had to protect him from telling him about Astrid's death. So for so many months, we have held it back from him. But last week, when he laid on the bed, I gradually broke it to him. I told him somebody that he loved a lot, who had worked with him, has gone to meet the Lord. That is what I proceed with. She has gone to meet the Lord. And he looked at me. He can't talk, but use his hand, his right hand, to say, "Who is it?" He didn't say it, but his hand said it. So I said, "It's Astrid." His eyes beamed open, and the tears start flowing. I'm telling you, I was so broken with seeing him, tears running from his eyes when he heard of Astrid's death. I said, you know, she has not just died. She has died a few months ago, and she was buried, but they are going to have a memorial service for her. And I know that he wished to have been here, but of course he can't be here and in his bed. And this morning when I told him, depending on which nurse would have come to sit with him, he said, I spoke to him, I said, "I'm going up to the memorial service." And he understands my talking to him, and he understands everything, but just can't express himself vocally. But then I said, "I'm going up." And so he made actions with his hand. And what I'm saying here, I'm saying on his behalf, that Astrid meant the world to him. Of course, I mean a greater world to him. Eh? But, you know, while he shared in this church, pastoring the church for 20-something years, Astrid meant so much to him. She was a secretary, and she went beyond being a secretary. I remember that time it was typewriter, not computer, and she used to type all his messages, his Bible study, and everything. I mean, just called on Astrid, and she was there. And, you know, I'm saying this to say that Astrid meant so much to him. He depended on her, because, as I said, not many people were able to type and do all those things that she did. And even when he made some errors, she will call him and say, "You made an error. You know, I did a correction," and so on. That's the sort of person she is. And for myself and my three girls, well, young people, you know, I know they loved Astrid a lot. The youngest one, Raquel and Ramona and Sharon, they all were in the church, and they benefited from what she has done. And I'm saying on behalf of George Raymond Frederick, and Sharon Ruth Frederick, Ramona Frederick, and Raquel Frederick, and myself, sleep in peace, Astrid. You have done a great job. Amen.
Thank you very much. Can we have the video from Ron at this point? And then we would have the scripture reading by Francine. And then we have the word of comfort. So let's have the video now, please.
It's been a long day without you, my friend, and I'll tell you all about it when I see you again. We've come a long way from where we began. Oh, I'll tell you all about it when I see you again, when I see you again.
Damn. All the planes we flew, good things we've been through. Then I'll be standing right here talking to you about another path. I know we love to hit the road and laugh, but something told me that it wouldn't last. Had to switch up, look at things different, see the bigger picture. Those were the days, hard work forever pays. Now I see you in a better place. See you in a better place.
How can we not talk about family when family's all that we got? Everything I went through, you were standing there by my side. And now you gon' be with me for the last ride.
It's been a long day without you, my friend. And I'll tell you all about it when I see you again. We've come a long way from where we began. Oh, I'll tell you all about it. When I see you again,
first you both go out your way and the vibe is feeling strong and what's small turn to a friendship turn to a bond and that bond will never be broken, the love will never get lost. And when brotherhood comes first, then the line will never be crossed. Established it on our own when that line had to be drawn. And that line is what we reach, so remember me when I'm gone.
How can we not talk about family when family's all that we got? Everything I went through, you were standing there by my side. And now you're gonna be with me for the last ride.
So let the light guide your way. Yeah. Every road you take will always lead you home. Oh, oh. It's been a long day without you, my friend, and I'll tell you all about it when I see you again. We've come a long way from where we began. Oh, I'll tell you all about it when I see you again, when I see you
another video. I don't know if you have it or you don't. Oh, okay. All right. Before I call Francine, we have Pastor Shelly Ann Bonnity. She's here and she has some of Astrid's favorite quotes that she's going to come and read. While she's coming, for those of you who are viewing via YouTube and Facebook, thank you for participating.
Good afternoon to everyone. I'm going to spread love everywhere I go. It's one of Astrid's favorite quotes, spread love everywhere you go. Let no one leave your presence without feeling loved. Astrid believed that a beautiful soul has the ability to love deeply and accept people for who they are. Do not judge according to appearance, but judge with righteous judgment, taken from the concept taken from John chapter 7 and verse 24. When those judgments are based on principles of righteousness, our focus will more fully turn to the Lord Jesus Christ. We will increasingly rely on the perfect judgment, mercy, and grace, rather than on mortal accomplishments or imperfections as a basis of judging. Be aware of the deception of the gradual. This is one of Pastor Frederick's sermons that stood out to Astrid, the deception of the gradual. Astrid aptly applied this quote in everyday conversations, referring to the brief, temporary, transient nature of life on earth. When challenged on being philosophical, she would quickly respond that the Bible says, "For we were born but yesterday. Our days on earth are as transient or fleeting as a shadow." Job chapter 8 and verse 9. The best way out is through. Robert Frost. She quoted this as she tried to make sense of her own pain. And for every quote she had, she made a connection to a relevant song and she sang it. Her family has a recorded version of her in the hospital singing this song. "And the toils of the road will seem nothing when I get to the end of the way." Romans chapter 8, verses 38 through 39. "For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus." And to leave us with one of her quotes again today by Steve Magram, it says that we should make the best use of our lives. This is Astrid's advice to all of us. We must never forget two truths. First, compared to eternity, life is extremely brief. Second, is only a temporary resident. We are not human beings having a temporary spiritual experience. We are spiritual beings having a temporary human experience. Let's take Astrid's quote to life, spread some love, because life is brief.
Thank you, Pastor Shelley. Astrid had her quotes, but Astrid loved songs too. One of the things that we enjoyed in the last few months was playing some calypsos. That Brother Ebony have nothing at all. Or come out in your numbers. There's a meeting here tonight. There's a meeting in the market square. You know, oh, this society need a spectacle. And so we play some of these calypsos over the last couple of months, listen to them and laugh. And it was just such a blessing to hold those experiences in the closing days of our life. I would always remember them. And this, guys, this is such a hard thing to do. Astrid was such a central part of our lives. It's really difficult. I've not had anything that is so traumatic and painful for decades. But at this time, I want to invite Francine to come and read a scripture for us.
Good afternoon, church. The scripture reading is taken from St. John, chapter 14, verses 1 through 4. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know. Parents reading.
Thank you very much, Francine. At this time we want to, let's all stand together, please, as we welcome Dr. Peter Barnaby, who will share the words of comfort with us this afternoon. Please come.
Thank you, Kevin. Be seated, everybody. And good evening. It's good to be home. And I want to honor the pastor of the church. I believe Pastor Reverend Dr. Holly Souls is his representative today. And just being here makes us reflect on so many incredible moments and memories. They're just so many, it's hard to kind of even itemize them. But I'm really supremely excited to be here. I wish it was under better circumstances. But I just want to thank you as a church for the investment of training and discipline that we received whilst we were young members of this congregation. Eudine was my Sunday school teacher and made me the heavyweight champion of the world in Bible boxing. And I learned every scripture verse possible. We had to learn chapters. And I thank you. And all of you who are here who journeyed the passage from when we were at Hilltop Tabernacle on the mountaintop up there, and the very cruel commands to walk that road every Sunday and back, and let alone the many peanuts we stole from people's properties in the name of the Lord. But I want to thank you as a congregation. I wish I had time to just enumerate the many blessings we've had and how that has shaped the formative years of our spirituality, making us effective at what we do today, not only in the United States, but across the world. I want to take this opportunity to honor the matriarch of this tribe, the Haynes tribe, that is of my siblings and our children, our grandchildren. I've never seen an individual tribe multiply so fast. It's just incredible what Kevin is doing. But and Ronald and myself and Petra, all of us. But Luther L. Haynes is the most incredible mother in St. Vincent and the Grenadines, and I would extend to the world. I'm going to ask everybody to stand, put your hands together, and celebrate this incredible matriarch. Just turn around, put your hands together. Do it real good, all right? Do it real good. Do it heartily. And, Mommy, I want to thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, firstly, for loving my daddy. And that gave birth to Ronald and Kevin and myself. Thank you so much for the parenting, for the loving abuses. The way we were flogged, we just had to be disciplined. I just love the way we were trained. And to be honest with you, it took us, by the way, when I say abuse, you all know what I'm talking about. Because in the black community, we talk about how we were trained and the way we were raised. And it made us become so incredible at living. You know, when I look across my siblings, I see the brilliance, the mental brilliance, the intellectual capacity that I see in all of us when we sit down to reason and to talk through things, just that sense of critical thinking and correct thinking that punctuated our lives, that helped us to navigate through the shifting fortunes of life, that kept all of us out of prison, and that kept all of us away from a life of debauchery and recklessness. And we've all done very, very well. I celebrate them. I reverence all of them. And Astrid, of course, was one of the no-nonsense ones. But such an incredible group. I'm just going to ask you to stand. Ronald, would you stand? Ronald is the firstborn and the best looking. I was going to get to that, but we can't tell the way you have that mask on there. But but one of the most loving species of a human being I have met. Ronald is just such a gentleman. I would like to be like him when I grew up. You know, and then Kevin, I'm told his name means handsome. When they gave him that name, they thought I was born. But you know, and his name is testifies of him, great businessman, great sense of accomplishment, and also with such a philanthropic heart that serves in the community. I really salute him as well. And then, of course, her favorite, the brightest, the greatest, the bravest son. That speaks to you now. I don't really want to call his name, but you know, my name Peter means rock, so I'm like the rock of Gibraltar in the family. But I really am thankful for average children myself, and I know the challenges. Mommy did an amazing job. When I think about washing clothes without a washing machine, and back then she used to hang them online. These days you can't tell children about online. They go on their phone to do something online, you know what I mean? But she was hanging clothes on the line, washing clothes without, the ease of machinery. But did all of that and then had to sweep the yard, cook the food, dress us all to go off to school, help with homework when we came back. What an incredible woman of God. And once again, Mommy, I salute you. And then she had three amazing young ladies. Astrid has gone on to be with the Lord. Rainey, if you don't, Rainey is the one that carries, like, she wields two swords in her hands. And very, very disciplined, well put together. Rainey is so incredible that most men are afraid to marry her. So. And of course, Carrie is again so well spoken, gracious, loving, and in a way like Rainey. So y'all help me pray. I need some brother-in-laws. And of course Petra, we had not interacted for a while, but I mean, so well cultured. If you interact with Petra, you think she belongs to the royal family. And I think she really does. Raising two wonderful children, takes care of an amazing husband. And I really just want to celebrate with you guys, let you know I love you with my life. So, but Astrid is a phenomenon. Astrid was the most amazing one of our siblings, and she's multi-skilled, multi-faceted. You talk about critical thinking, you talk about correct thinking, and she also thinks commercially, because everywhere she went, she was basically managing millions of dollars, and would do so with such incredible discipline. Never found in anything. One person I know has gone on to be with the Lord is Astrid. You cannot find a fault in her life, except she could be very confrontational. I mean, I was a pastor for years, and whenever I had to bring her into the office for us to have a conversation, sometimes I'm beginning to explain something, and when she doesn't say Pastor Barnaby, I know I'm in trouble. When she said Peter, she like, Peter, stop right there. Stop right there. Let me tell you what's going on. And, you know, I'm never afraid of dissent. It's always an important quality of a good leader that you encourage dissent around you. And I really am so thankful for the quality of human, very mature, but very well balanced. If you know Astrid, she loved the Lord with every fiber in her being, but she also celebrated life. Like Kevin is saying, I mean, if we celebrate a birthday or a season like Christmas, she'll come in, we'll have some music playing, and she'll come with her own music. Santa looking for a wife, Santa looking for, you know. You know, or she's like, St. Vincent, my homeland, you give me no mansion, no gold, no diamond yet. I love you a million for the things that you have to offer, more than my heart's desire. Lovely beach. And she, now you guys want me to win the crown, right? But such an incredible celebration of life. She loved life, a little parang and her kaiso and so on. She did not allow any false sense of religion to block her ability to interface with the real world and to celebrate it. Yes, I love natural spirituality. And Astrid was the epitome of that, all right? But it's amazing, you know, one day we were, just before she passed, a few of us were there, and we started worshiping and praying, and she was lifting her hands and singing. She was singing, Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. And I was told when she passed, they were wheeling out for the final time to see the doctors. And it is said that she said to the people that were there, I'll see you up there. Now, she probably was still talking about the place where the hospital was. But it was like a prophetic moment when she said, I'll see you up there. Because she didn't go back to that place. She went on to be with the Lord. And I just want to use that prophetic statement as a launching pad, just to say a few brief encouraging words to all of us. I'll see you up there. And Francine read a few minutes ago from that passage, in my Father's house are many mansions. And if it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And there are several contradictions that are in that passage for those of us who have been around church and have heard that passage read time and again. Some of those contradictions include, you know, he said, in my Father's house are many mansions. How do you put a mansion in a house? There are two separate Greek words used there for house and mansion. So he has to be saying something that we have not understood. In my Father's oikos are many mansions. He put mansions in the house. But really what the text is saying is, in the realm of God, there are many positions to hold. And then he says, I go to prepare a place for you. Now, you will agree with me that if God created the whole world in 7 days, how does it take him 2,000 years to build a mansion? So he couldn't be talking about building a house, and we've been singing songs that say, we talk about him putting on the roof. The people who say, well, he's putting on the roof now, my mansion's already done. I mean, it can't take him 2,000 years to build your house. I mean, so he couldn't be talking about a physical edifice. And so Philip says to him, Lord, show us the Father. You said you're going to the Father. I want to go too, but show me the Father. And he says, Philip, I've been with you a long time. How don't you know me? He just erased the idea that we have to travel a long distance in the universe to get to the realm of God. You know, Philip is like, Lord, who is the Father? Show us the Father, and that will be enough. He said, no, Philip, I've been with you a long time. How could you not know me? And then Philip said, all right, then just show me the road. And the Lord Jesus said, Philip, I am the way. I am me. This person is the way. Clearly, what he was saying to the people was that heaven is not just a physical location. Many people have wrestled with the idea about what heaven is. And then you hear him in what we call the Lord's Prayer when he said that the will of God in heaven must be done on the earth, meaning the earth must be colonized after the prototype of heaven. Consequently, whenever you look in anyone who had a vision of heaven, they always see things that are on the earth. Like they see animals. Like one man would say, I see a lamb and I see a lion. Though it may be indicative of the character of Jesus as the sacrifice and as the triumphant one, we can say that. But then he sees people with clothes on. You know, they've got robes. I got a problem, though, with how traditionally we've looked at the idea of being in heaven, and all of us have one suit of clothing. It's a white robe. You know? And so there is this frustration we have with trying to figure out what heaven is. Some have seen heaven and they see horses. They see musical instruments and people are singing. They see roads and they see highways and they see seas, as though heaven is a prototype of the earth. And Randy Alcon did a book, an audio book. It'd be great to get it. And he says heaven is the earth in its perfected state. There is something marvelous about the concept of heaven. And Jesus says, I am the way to heaven. I, me, the person of Jesus. The mystery is that the Lord Jesus Christ is the real example of who we all should be. And that at our redemption, there are two ways we get to the place of immortality. And Paul talks about it. He says something. I'm going to show you a mystery. What is that mystery? He said, everybody's not going to die. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all die. That is a mystery. What is the mystery? Some will die and get to immortality. But then he said, we shall all be changed. We shall all be metamorphosized. We shall all come into something spectacular. Because this human being lost its power when man sinned. Jesus is who we are. Jesus is the essence of all biblical truth. He is the center of biblical revelation. And so our destiny is to become who he is, a master of devils, a master over the material universe. He conquered time, space, and matter. Jesus could not be controlled by poverty or disease. He is that place that he was talking about. He said to Philip, Philip, you don't have to journey to get there. I am the way. I am. Become me. And the whole idea of all of Scripture is to go back to the original intent. Man was made to be like God and to represent God. Man was to be made in the image and the likeness of God. We are like God and we represent God. The point I'm trying to make here is that, you know, when we think of
the death, and we think of passing, and we think of where Astrid is gone, where she is. She's not only in a location, she's in a superior place of being. See, you know, you can't but see it that he speaks of going up. We are caught up, and everybody is looking to ride the clouds. The idea of being caught up is to move to a superior state of existence. The idea of God, like God says, I am, my thoughts are greater than your thoughts. My thoughts are higher than your thoughts. He didn't say you can't get them, he just said they are higher. So that when we live, we must understand that as we pass from this life into the next, our journey brings us to the place of complete Christ-likeness. Jesus is the center. He is why he is here to show us who we really are. He says, as I am, so are you in this present world. And that changes our concept of the world. This is our Father's world. The world is a beautiful place. You fly over the snow-capped mountains of the Alps of Italy, and you fly over the Sahara Desert. When you look at this beautiful, majestic world, think of it without sin. Think of it without all of the crime and the wickedness that is here. For the Bible does teach not that the earth is going to go out of existence, but rather God is going to purify it. God is going to sanctify it. Heaven is who he is. We become more and more like him through teaching, through prayer, through our study of the Word of God, through correction. All of these things, but there is a finality to this thing. That we ultimately become who he is. That you can say, I'm like God and I represent God. Let me tell you just a quick couple of things about heaven. When Astrid said, I'll see you up there. I'll see you in a superior place. That's a place of complete utopia. There's no sickness. There is no disease. You know, this realm of God, who Jesus is, cannot be affected by sickness and disease. You're not bound by the laws of this world. Jesus declares for us a complete utopia, sinless perfection, you know, longevity. It is the design of God that you live forever, that I live forever. You know, he speaks of a utopia of complete prosperity for all mankind and peace in all the nations of the world. In that day, Putin is vanquished. Donald Trump is vanquished. By the way, I'm a registered Republican. So I'm not trying to get political, but what I'm saying is there are people who have been moving in the same spirit of a Pharaoh, the same spirit of a Herod. And all of the people who have become mass killers and all of the people that move slavery all across the world. There is a world, there is a time and a place when all suffering is ended. When there is absolute peace for everybody. When I think of my sister, I believe she's gotten there before all of us. But what I do understand is heaven is a place of an incredible gathering. A gathering of all those who have faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. For we shall be caught up together with them in the cloud. Now, a massive gathering when we all meet one another. Let me see the hands of those of you who know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Push your hand up real high, proud and high. Come on, do it. Praise God. And then turn around to somebody and say, I'll see you there too. Come on, I'll see you there too. Hallelujah. Not only that, heaven is a place of continuity. That means when we meet, we will remember each other. The Bible says we'll be known even as we are known. When I meet Fidel, I'll be able to say, Fidel, you made it, man. You know, St. Vincent could move, but we have our way to be back. I'll remember how he used to sing. We can carry on conversation. We'll be able to have intelligent discussion about life that we had on the earth. Every time you look at the Bible and you see people, they come back and they're having a discussion about life. You'll be able to talk about your pain and suffering without feeling that pain anymore. Heaven is continuity, that place of our final redemption. is a place of continuity. So Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you. I want to finish right here. I go to prepare. Now, preparing a place has to mean something more than putting on galvanized. See, a lot of people think like that, you know. And some people, if they know they can't handle a mansion, they pray that God would build them a cabin in the corner of glory land. Because a mansion is a little too big. But what does he mean, I go to prepare a place? See, when Jesus went back to heaven, what he did was to legitimize, this is what the word means, to prepare a place, is to legitimize your claim to that place. That because of his death on the cross, you have a justifiable right to redemption. You have a guarantee. Hallelujah. You have a guarantee that you will make it. You have a guarantee of sins forgiven. At the cross, the Lord Jesus, he took your sin and my sin. It's a place of substitution. Jesus was the atonement, for God was angry with all of us. But yet when Jesus died, his anger was appeased. He atoned for our sins. Jesus is the substitute for our sins. You should have been punished, you know. Jesus is our redemption. He bought us back. It was a legitimate transaction. We were bought with a price, not silver or gold, you know. So he atoned for our sins. He redeemed us, you know. The Lord Jesus was our suffering, our substitute. He became poor that we might become rich. The Lord Jesus became sin that we might be the righteousness of God in Christ. And the truth about the matter is, we are the righteousness of God in Christ. We're not sinners saved by grace. Somebody lied to us and told us that we are the redeemed of the Lord. We are the righteousness of God. At the cross, Jesus legitimized your right to complete and total redemption. Finally, his death was efficacious. There is an effective, literal, tangible, something authentic happens inside of you. When I met Jesus Christ, the Lord of my life, we were here on the galvanized building. And I remember when George Frederick came and he preached. And he gave a little invitation. And I hustled down to the altar and discovered Kevin was there too. And we said what we knew as the sinner's prayer. And something happened organically, literally. There was an inward transaction that took place. I knew that day I was saved. You know, and I suspect Kevin was saved too. We left the altar transformed, completely transformed. Nobody had to follow us. Nobody had to come to our homes, beg us to come out. Nobody had to pray that we were going to remain saved and all that. We were oversaved. I mean, we came to church for women's meeting. And then we were getting everybody. Said, we save your duck, we'll save your sheep, we'll save your cattle. Anybody we met that didn't know Jesus as Lord and Savior, we didn't care if you were a gangster, we will walk all over this place leading people to Jesus Christ. One day we were up the road here, and we met a young guy named Hollis. Hollis was a spiritual Baptist. He was the leading spiritual Baptist. You talk about adoption, you know. And we met him, led him to Jesus right in the road. You know, we went down the road and met Colin, you know, that's there, Jesus' sister, and he was mocking at us. He said, I don't have any problems with you guys. I mean, there, Jesus' brother, rather. And Colin said, I can't stand you guys. You guys, the moment you get saved, you start talking like Americans and fathering God. You know, it took us a little while, but he made a decision to follow Jesus Christ. We were blood washed, saved, I mean sanctified, inside and outside. Walked with Jesus and never stopped. Never stopped. We preached at everything. I was preaching in the bush when nobody was there. We used to go in the hillside and pray and worship alone, fasting when nobody told us to fast. You know, I remember one time I was in the bush and I was praying with my Bible, the rain came, the Bible was swelling. And a gentleman was there listening to me, and he came up. He said, young man, what are you doing there? I said, I'm suffering for the gospel like the Apostle Paul. But we had a real inward experience. I want you to know that knowing God is a real experience. This was not a figment of our imagination. It was not a myth. It was not a legendary story. This was not something that tickled our fancy and gave us some thrill running down our spine. We didn't feel all of that. We weren't falling out on the ground everywhere, but completely and totally transformed. And up to this very moment, I still am in love with him. After all these years, we just keep falling in love with Jesus all over again. That's the faith my sister found. And never relented through her limp, frail body. When her stomach hurt and her back hurt, when she stood there and would go curl up next to mommy and wept her way out of this material world, she did not leave without hope. My sister held on to the blood-stained banner of the cross. And from her heart, she trusted God. And I'm guaranteed this day that she has found the heaven that is real. She lives in a superior place. I guarantee you, cancer cannot touch her again. She's immune from all sickness and disease. Hallelujah. And today, I invite you to this one. May this day be a day that challenges you and brings a mountain of evidence that Jesus is the Savior of the world. I still believe in the exceptionalism of Christ Jesus. I believe he's superior to every world religion. Islam, you know, Buddha, Baha'u'llah, Shintoism. It does not matter what the religion is. Jesus Christ is the superior one. He's the Savior of the world. I think that's a great place. Everybody should say. And may today be a day of redemption. May you allow Astrid's passing to challenge your faith. What will happen when I leave this world? My faith is that you find him. Bow your heads with me, if you will. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for this moment. We've come apart from the joys of life and from the routines that would otherwise have kept us away from this memorial. And I'm thankful for every soul that is here. Thank you for well wishes. Thank you for those who prayed for Astrid and for her family. I am praying today that they will find authentic faith that brings a real experience of God in the name of the Lord Jesus. I ask that you will keep us off satanic radars. Make us invisible to satanic weaponry. Cause us to walk in absolute victory in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. May we live this life like Jesus would, with the character of God, with the victories of God, the prosperity of God, the healings of God. Cover us, clothe us, crown us in the name of Jesus. May the work of Jesus on Calvary's cross break every curse, stop every judgment. In the name of Jesus, and abort every negative harvest. May we experience his love and his power in a real and a tangible way. Bless us all together as we fellowship around the scriptures and as we fellowship in this community. And may we be kept by his power forever. In Jesus' name. Kevin.
Praise the Lord. As we prepare to disperse, we're going to have Pastor Fidel Taylor. He's going to come. He's going to sing as we are dispersed. But the Lord bless you and keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you and give you peace. May the Lord God of heaven bless the work of your hands. May he bless your going out and your coming in as you traverse the rest of this day. God bless you. Thank you for coming. Thank you for being a part of this memorial service. God bless you. Really, really good. Renee, you were saying? Sorry.
She's reminding me that we have a repast. It's at the parish hall in Calico. And you are invited to be part of it. If you have the time and you want to continue the fellowship, please feel free to come join us in that space. Pastor Taylor, you want to come? And as he sings, we can be dismissed. God bless you really, really good. Amen.
Stand with me, please. Father, we give thee thanks for what transpired here today. And as we leave with the assurance that Astrid is in a better place, and we too, if we keep the faith, will be joining her in that place as well. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your grace. Come on, just worship the Lord with me one more time. Give thanks with a grateful heart for all that he has done and he's doing in us and through us. Hallelujah.
By the power of your love.
Strong in Jesus.